so you guys know, right? So for example, when you go to the image, right, you do out the tone, out the contrast, out the color. You're basically using techniques which were, you know, about 60 years old. And of course, even so when you make all these adjustments to improve quality of image, you're basically using image processing. But of course, like the image processing, I usually want to do it all automatically, you know, because these planes and satellites are bleeding lots of images and you don't want to do it by hand, right? But it's interesting that what was available, the space program, military, and other industries, in 50 years, only was added to software, right, and also cameras, definitely decade. And of course, what's interesting is for many people, right, they think of image processing like this, right? So it actually becomes a way to distort images, right? But what's behind are exactly the same techniques, okay? Now, so the difference between the software which we use and something like Photoshop, so in Photoshop, right, when you go and you say, choose my histogram, okay, somewhere it is here, sorry. Where is it? Here's a histogram, and it can look the same, but I can't get these numbers out, right? So I'm going to use software that can actually get these numbers out, okay, such as imaging. Now, okay, can put this one. So what else can we do? Well, so as I said, you know, we can also, you know, basically instead of just making a histogram, we can measure, you know, different properties of the image. So we can go and set different properties we want to measure. Like, I'm not going to explain what all of them, but for example, mean is very obvious. A mean would be very great K value. The standard deviation would be the range of three values of the image, right? So I'm going to say, okay, I'm going to measure this, and then I'm going to say analyze, and here I'm going to get these numbers, right? So I can say, okay, that's kind of interesting. Well, what else can I measure? I can also measure saturation of the image. How? We're going to take this image, we're going to change it from RGB into hue saturation brightness. Right? You guys know about hue saturation brightness, right? So now we've got, you know, so what happens is because the image actually was pixelated, pixelation is enhanced, you know, there's more noise now. But what this would say, so this is our original image, which is just translated into brightness. So if I'm going to go and measure histogram, I'm going to go generate histogram, the results will be exactly the same. No, right? So here's a histogram. But this image, for example, right, this image is actually uses the brightness to represent the hue. Right? It uses brightness and the hue. So different hues are represented by different ratios. So if I measure the average gray value, I'm actually measuring the average color, whatever average color needs. Even this particular image is saturation. So I see that the areas which are almost black or almost completely black or white will be black. The areas which have very saturated color will be white. And you know, most of the colors in this image are kind of in between. So we encode it as gray levels. So now if I'm going to measure, right? I'm going to get this number 83, which tells me how saturated these images. Okay? So let's now, before we go on, let's actually now use these techniques to look at, for example, patterns. Again, not something very complicated. Look at the patterns across not a manga, but a particular web comic. Right? So we're going to import image sequence. Here's the angels, right? So what we can do is that, well, first of all, you know, before we actually measure it, let's just take a look at this. So we're going to use another function image, which is also available in Photoshop, but in image, because it's 3D, it actually works better. There's people like plugins. We're going to make a kind of a grid out of all the pages, right, in this comic. Let's see if it's going to work. Okay, so it's making it. Okay, we're done soon. Stop shooting here. to here. So basically, we can see that our, you know, this, it can cause it a stack because the program is mostly used for medical, for medical imaging. So the reason it calls it a stack is that, you know, people do laboratory where you go, you know, and so to say, kill like a mouse, right? Slice the brain, like in different slices, right? Like carpaccio, and then you put the microscope. So that's why we call slices. Right? Anyway, so here is, here's 340 pages from this comic books. Now, we already know what we're going to get because I showed you earlier, but let's see how I get this. So we're going to say, so we don't, if we want to measure brightness, we can immediately, we can one step both measure and plot it. So we're going to say plot the axis profile. And so Z, because it kind of thinks about each image, right, as organizing time, like on the Z axis. So basically this is it. So should we go? It's exactly the same graph, right, as we saw before. Now, from here, we can actually list these numbers, so we can copy them, right, into a spreadsheet, or we can simply take these numbers, right, and we can indeed put them in a spreadsheet. Okay, let's go. Well, we can actually have some spreadsheet, right, but then we can make a new one. So let's see if we can make a new one. Here you go, okay? So here's all your frames and here's your measurements, right? And just as we did before, we can now plot this, right? Okay, but let's do more. Let's do more. Okay, so now we're going to use a similar technique to measure average, or to measure properties of saturation, right? In this stack. So I wrote a little macro. So basically, this program has a macro language. So I wrote a macro, which looks like this. Okay, and basically it's like the smallest program you can see. So basically, what it does is just opens all the files in directory and converts them, as I already showed you, from RGB to the hue saturation brightness, and then measures the part of the image which is saturation. So we're going to do that and see if it's going to work. Yes. Okay, so this is our directory of images. Let's see. Okay, so now this takes a little bit longer, but doesn't take that long, right? So it's the same idea.
But this is not the macro.
This is no.
Are you running a macro?
I'm running this macro, right?
Against all the
stuff, right? Okay, but notice, you know, it takes a little bit longer, so, and of course what we're doing is measuring some very simple properties. Now, if you actually start kind of reading about this field, you realize that in fact there are hundreds of different visual features you can measure. So some of these visual features have immediate immunological meaning, right? For example, I understand what the hue is, I understand what brightness is. But people also measure various statistical properties of pixels, which have been used to, for example, separate images in terms of texture. So for example, if you, just to give an example, right? So let's say I want to automatically classify the different textures in this image. So what I can do is I can do a measurement which is not immediately but can be used with other measurements, like for example, I can look at each pixel, and I can look at basically the pixels around it, and I can ask, you know, how different are the pixels around it, sorry. So there are different things like that. Now let me show you some, you know, without going into all the kind of, you know, and there is a big field, there are tens of thousands of people who work in this field. You know, it's used a lot, right? It's used in medical imaging, it's used in automatic factories, where you have some automatic arm, right? Some kind of machine, which will be recognizing the object on a conveyor belt. So it's used a lot. Of course, used in surveillance, right? In military, in lots of different fields. And also in every single digital camera sold in the world, right? Because what happens is, you know, when you take a picture, the camera analyzes properties of the image, and for example, it automatically adjusts contrast, brightness, and saturation to give you the best possible image, right? So it's actually used all the time. No, what else? Okay, but let's do a couple of things which are maybe not so obvious. Let's say we automatically count, right, how many shapes are in this image. And instead of using this comic book, we're going to look at a couple of paintings. We're going to look at a couple of paintings. So we are going to take the big ones. Yes, we are going to take, for example, Courbet. So this is not my favorite, so we can take another one. Let's take a very famous image, which is maybe the last classical painting ever done, right? To some extent, 1849. We're also going to take something which is done a bit later, but it's called the kind of. Well, I don't know, we're going to take Kandinsky, okay. So, we can say, well, it actually would be meaningful in this case, right, to measure how many different shapes are in the image, because one of the things, right, we talked about reduction, and of course, you get another reduction, which happens in the late 19th, early 20th century, is the reduction in painting, right, where the kind of 19th century realism gets reduced to eventually to simpler shapes and small number of elements. Right? So this is Kandinsky 1908 and this is Kandinsky 12. And of course eventually we're going to get to you know what, right? We're going to get to this, right? Well, so let's first of all try with this. So we can say Malevich may give us images which are particularly good for image processing because they're so kind of symmetrically clear, right? So distinct. So let's practice first. So one of the things which you know which we do a lot in medical biological resources, let's say we have some photographs done with microscopes of some biological tissue or maybe with some liquid and we want to count cells or other particles, right? So there is an effect when the program comes with a kind of something that is here, with even a sample set of biological images, which you can use to practice. Somewhere it's here, actually, let's see if you can find it. But it's a very good apply this technique to painting. Okay? So here we have analyzed particle function. Now we can ask it, for example, to only measure circle images or to only measure rectangle images. You can also ask it to measure shapes which are bigger than a particular particle size. So maybe for example we don't want to measure shapes which are single pixel because maybe it's noise in the image. And we also can ask us to show it what it does. So let's try it out. Okay, Malevich, here we go. Okay. It says well you know I'm sorry I can't do it. You have to first make the image into black and white. Okay, so we're going to do that. A little violence. Oops, you lost the shape. Well, okay, we can get it back, but okay, let's go forward. Okay, but now I got lots of these little pixels here, right, which I don't want to measure, right? So I'm going to go and I'm going to say, let's both measure shapes which are less than 10 pixels in perimeter, right? Okay, that seems to work, right? So here's the problem found. It found 8 shapes, and here's statistics for those 8 shapes, right? So you can say, well, maybe I can use this in particular cases, because you know, if I can think about particular, let's say, sets, particular areas in visual culture, where the number of shapes in the image is somehow important, right, for a style, for a genre, then I can use this, right? But first of all, let's see if it's going to work with something else. So let's work with ours. So that's Malevich was easy. Let's now do Kandinsky. Okay, so again, we're going to lose some information when we do it because I'm doing it completely. But basically, we can say that we can still recognize the image and we can do the same thing. Okay, so here we can get our part. This is exactly, for example, how computer vision works, how surveillance systems work, sorry. And we could do the same thing, for example, to Colbert, right? Now, so that's very interesting, but what about video? What if you want to apply these techniques to video? Okay. So obviously, you know, if you measure a single image, it's not so interesting, right? Because those numbers don't really do anything. It become meaningful, all, I think, right, you know, in the context of our numbers. So let's see if we can use these techniques to be able to describe patterns in motion graphics, right? So motion graphics, you know, is a very big area of contemporary culture. I haven't seen any theoretical article by any cultural critic about it ever, so might as well start, right? Let's start with something. Okay, so I have, so those of you who just maybe don't know what motion graphics is, I'm sure you do know, but let me just very briefly remind you. This one. So here we go, let's show some examples. Sorry. It's a bit powerful. Now, we can say that this using this image processing is a way to try to understand motion, is a way to try to describe motion graphics. It may be particularly useful because we can't really use our standard 20th century film theory. We don't have mise-en-scenes. You don't have traditional cinematography, you don't have characters. What you have is abstract animation, right? What you have is a 20th century language of abstraction, the language of graphic design, typography, painting, and now of course the visual culture, which is put in motion. And you know, if you look at this long enough, you recognize that there are some other interesting characteristics. I mean, but basically one of the most important ones, everything changes all the time, right? Not only that, but there are no standard shots, for example. So sometimes you have a film, such as this one, I mean, a short piece, which is a continuous transformation, right? It's like as long as you have a musical signal, which is continuously modulated. So we can't even go and break this into shots, right? So, and because obviously the visual changes are very important to contemporary design, including motion graphic design, it would be quite meaningful if we can analyze and visualize these patterns of changes. Because maybe we can start building kind of taxonomy of different types of motion graphics. Okay? So the idea is that when you invent new methodology or new tool, right, you don't simply just want to blindly, right, apply to anything. And I think one of the problems of humanities is, you know, we have some very smart people in the beginning, right? So, who for example said, okay, in the late 60s, we said, okay, let's like Julia Kristeva, right, or Christian Metz, who said, okay, let's apply psychoanalysis to culture. Okay, but you know, we apply it to very particular artifacts which we selected, it makes sense. And then 10 years later, you have a typical graduate student who just applies it to anything, and often doesn't work, right? So not every methodology can be used with. So I think maybe in contrast to scientific methodology, which is let's make experiments and let's repeat them, until you find out something, you know, you have to kind of fit your methodology with your objects of study. So I'm not suggesting that this approach, which I'm now showing you, should be applied to anything blindly, but if, you know, in the case of motion graphics, it seems to make more sense, because if you try to describe various visual properties of this video, of this animated pieces using language, it would be very hard, because language is not very good, for example, describing different types of motion. So let's try that, okay? Let's try that. So we go back to image A. Okay? We're going to go and open a couple of motion graphic pieces. Let's take a couple of things. And I like it because it's also very short. short, so it won't take forever. Okay, so let's actually put it in memory, so it's going to be pretty fast. So here it is.
Question?
Yes, please.
Do I understand that you have some question about the value of doing a textual, and I would say taxonomic seems to fit that also, analysis of motion graphics? I mean...
What question do you...
Well, I guess you could see it as a progression from text to motion graphics. And is this an attempt to come back, to complete the circle and take the motion graphics back to text, to textual analysis?
Yes. Well, I would say, I would probably say not quite. In fact, I was going to get to it, but you know, I might as well kind of put my cards on the table. I think that, well, let me kind of give you maybe a short answer, and then after, we'll do more of it. Maybe we can come back to it after we do more of it. So I think that the reason that maybe evolutionary, the human brain developed both like a visual system and a linguistic system, is I think the different forms of representation are kind of complementary. And we all know about it, right? I mean, you know that, for example, it's actually not true because you can find counterexamples, but supposedly, for example, the language can be used to talk about particle in general, casuality. And then you can't really do the images, but the images seem very good with spatial relations and geometry, topology, etc. So that's why I think the attempts to describe images with text are always going to be very limited, right? Because I think that these two different semiotic or cognitive systems, you know, we just can't be perfectly translated into each other. So when we try desperately to describe visual properties with language, you know, there's always going to be lots of things which are just going to be left out. So what I would like to propose is that it needs visualization as a new technology of describing, right? It's basically describing. Now, the point is that after the visualization, do we have to then impose and add some linguistic labels? So for example, if we're going to describe different patterns, do we need reducing the, that's actually something which, you know, which is on the table, right? And in fact, that's exactly what we'll be exploring, like, you know, the rest of day to day when we go to manga, right?